Hi, and welcome to Guided Biology. This is the first video on a series that will cover the endocrine system. In this video, we are going to be going over some introductory topics relating to the endocrine system, including some terminology and some information about how hormones work. But before we get started, please like this video and subscribe to our channel so we can reach as wide an audience as possible. Okay, let's start by discussing the two major regulatory systems in the body, one of which is the nervous system and the other is the endocrine system. The nervous system communicates with its target cells by sending electrical signals called action potentials. Action potentials can be sent very quickly from the neuron to its target cell, and once that signal is sent, it's gone. Meaning regulatory signals from the nervous system are generally very short-lived. Now, if we compare that to the endocrine system communicates with its target cells by releasing hormones, which then travel through the blood to find its target tissue. And because that hormone has to travel through the blood and the systemic circulation before it can find its target tissue, this can take some time, meaning endocrine regulation is typically slower than nervous system regulation. Also, because hormones can remain circulating in the blood, regulation by the endocrine system tends to be longer lasting. Now that we have a basic understanding of the regulatory systems, let's focus on the glands, their secretions, and how those secretions find their target cells. The most basic type of gland that everyone is familiar with is called an exocrine gland. In an exocrine gland, the glandular cells will secrete their product, and it will travel out through a duct. A duct is just a hollow tube-like structure, typically made up of cuboidal cells. And these ducts will carry that secretion to the surface of the body or the lumen of whatever organ that exocrine gland is secreting into. There are a few different categories of glands that do not secrete into ducts. The first we're going to talk about is going to be the focus of the series, and that is endocrine glands. As I said before, endocrine glands are going to be secreting hormones, and it will secrete them directly into the blood. A hormone, by definition, is just a long-distance chemical signal. In addition to endocrine glands, there are also paracrine glands. These are glands that are going to secrete their product, and it will travel locally and act on neighboring cells. There are also autocrine glands. Autocrine glands are going to secrete their product, and it is actually going to feed back onto the secreting cell and influence that cell. When we talk about target cells, a target cell is going to be any cell that is influenced in some way by a chemical signal. What allows a target cell to respond to a secretion, for example, a hormone, is that those cells have a receptor that is specific for that hormone. So when we are talking about endocrine glands and the fact that they secrete their hormones into the blood and those hormones travel throughout the circulation, a logical question would be, why don't hormones affect all of the cells in the body if they're going through the blood to all of the tissues in the body? And that is simply because only some cells have receptors for those specific hormones. So in order for a cell to be influenced or changed by a hormone, it must have a receptor for that hormone. Now, let's spend a little time talking about some categories of hormones and where their receptors are located on a general cell. We can categorize hormones into two different groups. They are either water-soluble or fat-soluble. Water-soluble means that they can dissolve in water, so these are typically going to be polar molecules. And fat-soluble means that they can dissolve in fats, which means they are typically non-polar. If you're having some trouble remembering polar versus non-polar, water-soluble versus fat-soluble, I will link you to some of our videos below that will go over those topics. It's important to understand if a hormone is water-soluble or fat-soluble because that's going to have a very large impact on where the receptor for that hormone is located. Remember, the membrane of a cell is made up of a phospholipid bilayer, which is nonpolar, and so for anything to move through that membrane without help, it needs to also be nonpolar. That means that water-soluble hormones are not going to be able to enter a cell, and so their receptors are going to need to be located on the surface of the cell. These are called extracellular receptors. A water-soluble hormone will bind to its extracellular receptor, and that will cause a response on the inside of the cell. Here we have an example of what could happen when a water-soluble hormone binds to its extracellular receptor. In this case, that receptor is a G-protein-coupled receptor, simply meaning that the receptor is coupled or associated with a G-protein. And when the water-soluble hormone binds to that receptor, the associated G-protein becomes activated, and it can travel along the inside of the membrane until it finds its target, in this case, adenylyl cyclase, which is a membrane-bound enzyme. And the G-protein will then activate that adenylyl cyclase, and then that adenylyl cyclase will convert ATP into cyclic AMP. Cyclic AMP is a very common second messenger in cells. A second messenger is just referring to the fact that we have our first messenger, which was our water-soluble hormone, and because that cannot enter into the cell, it needs to activate a second messenger on the inside of the cell. And then the second messenger can go on to have a wide variety of effects on the cells that just depend on the hormone and its receptor. In this case, cyclic AMP is acting on kinases. Fat-soluble hormones act through a very different mechanism. Because they are fat-soluble, they can travel through the membrane of the cell and bind to a receptor located inside of the cell. These are called intracellular receptors. When the hormone binds to its receptor, they form a complex that can then go on to have varied effects on the cell. In this case, the complex travels into the nucleus of the cell and interacts with the DNA, influencing gene expression. The target cell itself also has some say in this regulatory process. They can influence how sensitive they are to a specific hormone by either upregulating or downregulating their receptors. When a cell upregulates its receptor, that means they are making more of that receptor, and so therefore they are more sensitive to the hormone that binds to that receptor. Cells can also downregulate their receptors, making them unavailable to the hormones and therefore making the cell less sensitive to that specific hormone. And finally, before we start talking about specific endocrine glands and the effects of specific hormones, we need to review negative feedback. I do have a longer video that goes more in depth into negative feedback and homeostasis. I will link that in the description. But here we're just going to review the general concept. The purpose of negative feedback is to always restore the system to homeostasis, to its balanced set point. Here I am going to use blood glucose as an example of homeostasis. Blood glucose is typically kept within a relatively small range. Whenever blood glucose increases, say after you've eaten a meal, the pancreas will make the hormone insulin, which will allow your body to take that glucose out of the blood and put it into the cells, and that will decrease blood glucose. On the opposite side, if your blood glucose gets too low, say you haven't eaten for a few hours, your pancreas will release the hormone glucagon. And glucagon will stimulate your body's cells to release glucose into the blood, bringing blood glucose levels back up. This example shows you that negative feedback is a mechanism used to maintain homeostasis, meaning it helps to maintain the stable value of certain variables in the body. And it accomplishes this by being able to correct for changes in either direction. Whether something becomes too high or too low, the negative feedback system can restore it back to that stable value. We're going to discuss several examples within the endocrine system of a negative feedback loop. So that's it for this video and our introduction to the endocrine system. In the next part of this series, we're going to start talking about some specific endocrine organs, starting with the pituitary gland and the hormones they make and what effects those hormones have. I hope you found this video helpful. And if you're interested in even more resources, we have some excellent study tools available for purchase in our shop. You can find the link in the description box below.